good morning, and a very happy, slightly soggy Thursday morning to everyone. I'm Jill Zielinski, the Director of Supports Coordination for the ARC Alliance, and your host for today's program, where I'm lucky enough to have Senator Judy Schwank with us today, and we'll be talking about legislative initiatives. So thank you very much for being here today. I'm thrilled.
I'm glad to be here, Jill. It'll be a good conversation.
I hope so. We have a lot to talk about, really. And actually, right before we get into the show, I just wanted to take a minute and talk about the ARC Alliance and upcoming rally that we will be having. The rally is going to be on May 12th, and it's going to be on the steps of the Doylestown Courthouse. But it's a regional rally, and what we are doing is the rally is for Broken Promises to Mom. It is the rally for crisis. It will be on Mother's Day, Saturday, May 12th, from 10 till noon, on the steps of the Doylestown Courthouse. And what we are asking is that you come down and join us, help us support mothers and families with children with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And we'll be talking about the state budget crisis. So please join us for that event. Okay. Moving on, I'd like to start with our mission statement. The ARC Alliance seeks to promote the best possible lives for the individuals we serve. Our advocacy services, educational programs, and efforts are directed towards improvement in the lives of children and adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities. The ARC Alliance envisions a society that has appropriate supports, services, and safeguards for all people with developmental disabilities so that they can fully participate in their community. We strive to ensure that legal protections for adults with developmental disabilities and children are upheld, developed, and utilized to further promote inclusive and supportive communities. We at the ARC Alliance believe that all people have the right to participate in society, to be productive, to develop and maintain relationships, and to have the opportunities to pursue their dreams. So, I thought perhaps Senator, we could start with the governor has proposed a state budget in February. And can you please explain the state budget process, how it works, how do budgets get finalized for
sure,
us?
Sure, Jill. What happens is the governor, as you said, stands before both bodies, both the Senate and the House of Representatives, and presents a budget, a proposed budget. And what then happens is that each of those bodies looks at that budget, reviews it. We have hearings, and those are actually conducted by the Appropriations Committee. So almost immediately after the budget is released, you will see, you know, on local news, and if you turn into some of the statewide stations that cover state government, you'll see senators, in my example, for instance, talking with secretaries of different agencies and questioning them about the proposed budget and how they intend to implement the guidelines that the governor is setting forth. So that's the first part of the process. Then later on, what happens is each body, again the Senate and the House, rolls out enabling legislation, sort of vehicles to move that budget through so that we can vote. And one thing that I've learned in my year and 1 month as a state senator is that not every, you know, the budget isn't just one big giant block of, you know, everything from the Department of Agriculture to the Department of Public Welfare. Education is dealt with separately. DPW, the Department of Public Welfare, is also dealt with somewhat separately. So you have the opportunity to vote on different aspects of the budget. You just don't have to vote one way or the other.
Oh, okay.
So where we're at now is that the enabling legislation has been put in place, and we'll be having those discussions on the Senate floor about what stays, what goes, what gets increased, hopefully.
Hopefully increased.
Yes.
That's
yes.
Going to be one of the ones that we're definitely going to talk about today. Just to explain a minute about funding for services for individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities. There are actually two primary ways to receive funding for what's known as home and community services. And home and community services are services that, by their very definition, are given in an individual's home or in the community. This includes everything from residential programs to day programs, job support, habilitation, which is where we have staff come into a person's home to help them work on independence. And the primary funding sources for that type of service, which again by its very definition is outside of an institutional setting and in the home, is what's known as base funds, which are directly county funds, or also waiver funds. And waiver funds there's two main waivers that we work with. There's the consolidated waiver, right, which does not have a cap, which is why that is the waiver really that you would need if you were going to have residential services. And then there's the person family directed supports waiver, and that is the waiver with the cap. So in talking about funding, when you do a budget for developmental disabilities, it's going to include both waiver funds and home and community services. And then also, can you explain what the block grants are? Because that's something that's coming out this year.
This is complicated. I mean, because there are federal funding streams and there are state funds that get mixed together that help to support the kinds of services that you're talking about. But there is a specific block of funding that is human service funds for counties that is given to counties to be able to use at least in the past, on specific programs. But this year, the governor has proposed block granting that, but in addition to that, making a 20% cut in those funds. And that's a serious concern for counties who really have the mandate of providing these services and having oversight on them. It's not necessarily the state that does that. While I think counties are very happy to have flexibility, it's like you're giving with one hand and taking away with the other, because it's great to say you have flexibility. But it's almost insulting to say, well, you should be happy, we're giving you flexibility, and so much so we think you've wasted money in the past, we're going to cut 20%. So it's a huge concern. And I think some very specific services that are important here in Berks County are going to be reduced. And I think families are going to be very disappointed, and individuals will not get the level of treatment that they need.
Right. And I know included in that 20% cut, or actually something to note with that 20% cut, is that services that are entitlement programs, the county has a directive, has a responsibility to pay
for.
They
have to do it.
So that 20% is not going to come out of those programs. So unfortunately, what that winds up looking like is sometimes the Office of Developmental Program Services gets more than the 20% cut, because they have to make up for those programs that they can't cut because they're an entitlement system. What is your position on the 20% cut for
I think I made
programs?
That.
And I'm sorry to ask it twice.
No, that's okay. I mean, I think I've made it clear. I'm really very concerned about it. I think we've made so much progress in how we look at developmental disabilities and how we treat them. I mean, we've come leap years in many cases on how we address these issues that really can meet the needs of families. And then to, you know, 20% is a drastic cut in my opinion. Then to walk away from that commitment, I think, is leaving families and agencies and county governments in the lurch and not allowing us to really address what may be specific issues in Berks County may not be the same in Cambria County or in Allegheny County, other places in Pennsylvania. I think this is a troubling situation. And I'm hopeful, considering that there have been some extra revenues, you know, the revenue estimates that the governor had proposed were pretty far off. So there may be the possibility of readdressing some of these issues.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. And the county block funds will actually address that issue that you had just mentioned, where the issues and the population within different counties is different.
Right.
So this would actually allow Berks County to more tailor services depending on the needs of the Berks County citizens.
This is something that counties have been asking for a long time. I was a former county commissioner. And the HS, the Human Service Development Fund is what this fund is called, was a pool of money that we used specifically for programs that we couldn't have funded any other way, but may have been able to save dollars in other services that were provided. In other words, avert a problem or divert funding to something that came up as a specific new need. And that happens. And unfortunately, this is making that decision-making even harder and leaving out some of the services that you know, really could make a difference in the community and our individuals' lives. Concerned about it. Yeah. We know there's not money for everything. Right. We fully understand that. I think, you know, I could be on a program on every issue within the state budget and say, well, yes, this is going to create some problems. There are certain segments of our society, however, or issues that we need to address that there is no, you know, there are not many other alternatives. So that's why I'm so deeply concerned about the issue of mental health and services, social services.
And with that, I'm no longer feeling guilty about asking you the question twice, because I think it's important that people know that we do have an ally in you. And I'm really proud to say that, and I'm really glad to hear the things that you're saying. We're going to take a short break right now, and we will be back in just a few seconds. So if you could join us in a minute. Thank you.
You're watching The Arc, Building Bridges in the Community on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local issues, go to bctv.org.
Thank you very much for coming back with us, where I'm having an interview with Senator Schwank, who's been so kind to come on the program, and thank you for joining us again. Our next topic is actually the waiting list, and I have some numbers to throw out real quick. Currently in Pennsylvania, there are 16,000 people on the waiting list to receive services through the Office of Developmental Programs. And in Berks County, there are over 3,000 children and adults on the waiting list, with 155 of them in the emergency category. Can you discuss plans to address the waiting list, or how you think we should?
Well, I think, again, what we've got to remember is that these services assist families, they assist individuals as well. And a lot of people, you know, individuals who come through the system, up until the time they graduate, if they're, you know, they're in the school system, they are receiving a multitude of services. It's, you know, it's very encouraging, I think, to families and to the individuals in the program. And then when they find that they are either graduated or aged out of the system, it's as if you've fallen off a cliff.
Right.
The services just absolutely go away. And that's what we're talking about here, are those older individuals who, not older in the sense of senior citizen, but those who are not school age, who are now looking for workshop environments or group homes, or, you know, the opportunity to fulfill the capacity and capabilities that, you know, every human being has, no matter what their, you know, their intellectual capacity. They are going to find themselves sitting at home. Right. Instead of being at a, you know, in a facility or a place where they can really maximize their potential.
And I think what you're talking about is actually one of our most common questions that when individuals call us at the ARC for advocacy, one of their questions is that, you know, their child has just received services through school that
right.
were great and they were wonderful, but then they graduated. And a lot of parents aren't aware that the school system is an entitlement system.
Mm-hmm.
If you make the argument, every child has the right to receive an appropriate education. But after that, after they graduate, then the Office of Developmental Programs is not an entitlement system, meaning that when funding is available, you may be eligible for it, but all of a sudden, the child has graduated and is now at home 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and the parents are just really surprised that for the last 2 years there hasn't been funding for graduates.
It's deeply disappointing. And I, you know, there's a real human face to this. Mm-hmm. The other aspect that I see too, Jill, are older parents.
Yes.
Parents who are looking at their child and thinking, you know, I'm not going to be here mm-hmm. forever to be able to support my son or daughter. Who will help? What's going to be available? Where's my safety net? And as a society, I don't know how we walk away from that.
Right. And sometimes right behind that, we have siblings that all of a sudden their parents have died, and now they are caring for a sibling. They have they don't even know where to start. They're not even entirely sure what their parents have done.
Right.
And we are all of a sudden in an emergency situation where somebody is home alone, cannot be home alone because it's not safe. That is something that is equally coming up now. So you're right, we have an obligation to help, you know, anybody on especially the emergency list.
Exactly. Families need to be a primary resource, of course, but they're not always there. Or, you know, the situations vary. So I think that's something that we really have to focus on. I'm very concerned, again.
Yes. And on a absolutely different note, because I'm going to move on to unemployment right now. Sorry about that, but I know we had a lot that we wanted to get
in. There are a lot of questions. So
the unemployment rate is significantly higher for people with developmental disabilities than the regular population or at the large population. What do you think would be a good commitment to assisting citizens of Berks County to get jobs?
Well, certainly more workshop opportunities, more opportunities with a counselor or a guidance, you know, of someone who can guide individuals into employment opportunities. Perhaps we could take advantage of resources that are available through community colleges. I mean, I'm thinking outside of what
Absolutely.
Normally has happened, but really should be part of what we're doing.
And with the situation being the way it is, we have to look outside the box.
Exactly,
really, we have to look at natural supports also.
So I think that's critically important. The unemployment rate for people who with disabilities is more than double than what it is for the general population. And as it is, there's only about 20% of the population that's actually in the workforce. So it's, you know, we are not maximizing the potential and fulfilling our obligation, I think, to members of our society who need our help. It's obvious. It's not a question of, you know, cheating the system or trying to take advantage of it. It's very apparent to everyone that this is a need that must be fulfilled.
I think it's important for people to understand that at times the same crises that hit everyone in this country, with the situation being what it is and the funding being what it is, but it tends to hit the population of individuals with developmental disabilities harder.
Exactly.
The numbers tend to be higher.
You know, Jill, just quickly, yesterday, of course, in the Capitol, when we're in session, many individuals come up and, you know, try to meet with their representatives. They also hold rallies. And yesterday there was a rally of individuals with intellectual disabilities. And all of these people, young, old, middle-aged, parents, young children, were in the Capitol. And it was, you know, it was so neat to see. People advocating for themselves, and helped me to understand the potential that we're not realizing.
I hope the people at home can see that we both had giant smiles on our faces when you were saying that, because we absolutely love people to get out there and to speak to your senators, to speak to your legislators, and really let everybody know what's happening. At the beginning of the program, I talked about an upcoming rally that we have, which I'm going to plug again right now, just based on your answer. On May 12th, which is the Saturday right before Mother's Day, we will be having a rally of Broken Promises to Moms, Rally for the Crisis, which we are asking everyone to come out and support moms, support families about the state budget crisis, a lot of those issues that we're talking about right now. So please join us on the steps of the Doylestown Courthouse on May 12th from 10 till 12 o'clock. Thank you. So what is your opinion of the governor's proposed increase in funding to state institutions while we're cutting funding to the community services?
That is a very, you know, I was kind of surprised to see that in the governor's budget. I had the opportunity, Jill, to take DPW, Department of Public Welfare Secretary Alexander, to Hamburg State Hospital, school and hospital, and visit with families, advocates for individuals who are in the facility, And I think it was good for him. It was, I think, encouraging to the parents that they felt that Secretary Alexander was an advocate. I'm thinking that perhaps this increase is a bridge to what may be a further continuation of moving individuals back into the community that can. It almost appears to me, and again, this is, I'm not a professional as you are, that those individuals that are in those facilities are those that really will not be able, that are still there, are not necessarily going to be moving into other facilities in the community. Maybe some of them can, but I would think that the majority of them may not.
I think a lot of the families of the individuals that are there, they're very pleased with the
they're
state
very
center,
happy
to be honest,
with it.
And they really do not want their family member to
they
move.
They don't. It's not the model necessarily that we look at for the future, that really people need to be in the community. It's just not the way we deal with these issues anymore. And I think everybody gets that. But yet there are individuals mm-hmm. who are still there and may not make that transition. So I think this, I hope that this increase is a movement to help bridge that issue and perhaps look at inevitable consolidation of some of these institutions. Already, so many of them have closed, and I know you know many of them that are no longer here, but there are still some. And I think it's going to be necessary to have a few of them. But we'll move into a different mode, I think, very shortly.
I think that's a great point. I mean, we know that the cost of somebody living in an institution are nearly six times
it's very expensive.
What they would be for somebody to mm-hmm. live in the community. But we're not going to force anybody into doing something that they don't want to do. If the individual is happy, if the family is happy, we're not going to try to force anything on them that they are not ready for. Our whole goal is helping people to be happy and live full lives, and part of living a full life is getting to live where you want to live.
When we met with those parents, Jill, with Secretary Alexander, I mean, they had very poignant stories of how their son or daughter, or in some cases, niece or nephew, or just someone that they advocate for, not all of them were blood relatives, how they thrive in that setting. But when they were moved into a different, maybe a group home or back home, that physically and psychologically it was a huge issue, and they just didn't seem to be able to cope with that. And so they're very, very concerned about the future for their loved one, and they want to be sure that they're in the best environment for them. I can fully understand that. I think we all can. Mm-hmm. But I think going forward, the model will be to try to keep people in settings that are part of our community. We can't the idea of ignoring or shutting people away is just out of step with reality and modern society.
I want to thank you so much for coming on today. And like I said, as citizens of Berks County, you have a very good senator here.
Thank you, Joe.
I will be doing my best to try to get you to come back on the show.
I'd be glad to. Let's see where this funding goes
yes.
in the future.
Yes, absolutely. So please remember, call us, contact us, let us know what you would like to talk about, any questions that you may have. Again, thank you very much for joining us today. And I'm Jill Zielinski, Director of Supports Coordination for the ARC Alliance. And kind enough to be with me today was Senator Judith Schwank. Sorry.
No problem.
Didn't mean to mess up your name there. But thank you very much. And please feel free to contact us at any point if you have any ideas for the show. And otherwise, we will see you here the first Thursday of every month at 11 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you.